What you are watching is a scene from a new chapter in the Kin Fables tale titled The Stolen Child. 5 years ago, in 2013, the project debuted with Kin, an atmospheric short film that followed a young girl, a faceless knight on a pale white horse, and a circle of dancing spirits that linked their two worlds together. Kin went on to win Best Cinematography at the Fantasia International Film Festival in the Quebec Short Film category later that same year. The success of the picture led brothers Ben and Seb McKinnon to turn the standalone project into a trilogy, introducing both modern and high fantasy characters to the story and expanding their artistic potential in the process. Seb's own musical composition set the soundscape and drove the narrative in all three parts. And after losing his brother in late 2016, Seb has revived the world with an outstanding installment that hints at future chapters. This one is dedicated to Ben. I introduce and lead with these short films because I would like to talk about atmosphere and mood in this video. When one explores Seb McKinnon's work for Magic, mood is perhaps the most immediate quality that ties his pieces together and separates them from the rest. By looking at his cinematography, as well as the artists that influence him to paint, we can better understand how he develops the eerie, ephemeral worlds we see in his commissions. We can also get an idea of the power in conceptual art that ignores the tenets of realism in favor of leaning into the imaginary. Ultimately, I would like to talk about Seb's art because it presents a world of high fantasy without being bound to the rules and traditions of magic. Seb McKinnon grew up in Montreal, Quebec, Canada, alongside four wildly creative younger brothers. As kids, they made up Map Game, an imaginary role-playing game that utilized sketches of knights and armies to tell their stories, and played it everywhere they went. Eventually, the boys found magic. Seb was drawn to the illustrations and collected cards accordingly despite not knowing how the game worked. Given the energy in the family, to pursue anything outside of the creative arts as a career would have been remiss. So Seb enrolled in technical school, got a degree in illustration and design at Dawson College, and snagged a job at Ubisoft after graduating. He worked on the concept team for the Rainbow Six franchise before landing his first commission with Wizards of the Coast in 2012. Attended Knight in the M13 core set was Seb's first illustration, which aligned with the medieval Arthurian worlds that set the foundations for his love for fantasy. The image shows a knight atop an adorned horse beside a soldier carrying her lance and shield, both situated amidst a garden within the walls of a castle. The mood is hopeful and valiant. Seb used a palette of pastels across the piece, dropping light from above to highlight the power pose of the knight. The castle walls break in the background to center and draw our eyes towards her. The garden is full of growth, the sky has thick, wispy clouds, and all seems well in the kingdom. This piece debuted just after the Innistrad block, which as a whole could serve as the antithesis of the mood found here. It is also one of McKinnon's favorite planes, one where he feels most at home. Since Attended Knight, Seb has provided art for nearly 100 cards, and a strong majority of these pieces show dark, eerie, melancholic compositions. Art directors continually assign him black cards because of his ability to turn the macabre into something beautiful. It makes sense when we look at his influences within the visual arts. McKinnon credits the legendary Swedish fairy tale artist of the early 20th century, John Bauer, for his inspiration. The flat planes, the washed out watercolor palettes, and the slightly haunting, dreamy imagery is synonymous with Seb's style. He also credits Ivan Soliev as a contemporary artist he admires. Soliev's work taps into the strange and uses monochromatic figure work to generate a sense of dread in viewers. And Alan Lee, a concept artist for the Lord of the Rings film trilogy, mixes tightly rendered landscapes with much looser atmospheric elements like fog, water, and light to breathe life into the fantasy world. McKinnon employs these same elements in his work as well, which has become a staple of his style. Most of his illustrations depict characters outside, either grappling with some manifestation of the natural world, or emerging from it like an extension of its essence. It makes sense that his admiration for Newfoundland, where he enjoys filming because of its picturesque and otherworldly landscapes, would trickle into his art. Moss is the motif that gives growing ranks its mysterious mood, and fire and lightning generate chaos and destruction in Vandalblast. But perhaps the most useful and significant elements for Seb's narrative are fog and water. With these two devices, he is able to keep his renders loose and expressive, and heavily tap into the abstract. In the early days, fog and water could help set the scene and do exactly as you would expect. millennial Gargoyle, for example, would certainly read differently without that heavy white blanket beneath him, which renders this creature quite threatening despite his withdrawn posture. Unknown Shores, one of my favorite pieces in the game, is also different without that stringy mist that wraps around the seashells like tinsel. Vaporkin goes all in on the texture and cautiously draws the viewer in. Is she to be trusted, we may ask? This character, like the Gargoyle, is withdrawn, shy, reserved, and eerie. Many of McKinnon's subjects are. They are not imposing, but instead taciturn and quiet. If we think back to Kubrick, aren't these the much more terrifying characters? Not the ones that scream and surprise us through jump scares, but instead the immobile ones that say nothing at all. This idea leads me to what I believe was Seb's first standout artwork in Magic, Odunis River Trawler. The piece depicts a character who is able to bring back the dead, and is doing so in a frighteningly calm way. Apart from a dozen or so hands emerging from the still water, there is no movement. The character is outside in a barren, open swamp that shows very little signs of life. Like Stephen Bellatin's work, this landscape is heavily grounded in the real world, and without the creature in the center of the frame, it would work beautifully as a basic land for the game. To identify the mood, we can ask ourselves, how does this make me feel? Or perhaps, how would it feel to be there? To me, this piece is so successful because it requires no knowledge of the game to be understood. The haunting atmosphere inhabited solely by a steward of death is a trope that can be found in virtually any Western culture. It embodies the idea of resurrection, but with a cost. Seb's highly subdued color palette of light browns and grays evokes the emptiness of the themes at play, and perhaps recalls Alan Lee's depiction of the dead marsh in Tolkien's novel. The most striking aspect, though, is this very small brushstroke behind the character's head. In a composition that is almost entirely horizontal, it reminds us of the medium and gives an aura of mysticism to this creature. It is so subtle, yet so effective. It merges the background to the foreground, bending the rules of perspective, and lends just enough contrast to make the lifeless face stand out. Like in a dream, when everything makes sense until you catch a glimpse of the surreal, and you slowly realize you are asleep. Seb returned to this motif in Shadows Over Innistrad with Pale Rider of Trostad. This piece also shows another aspect of his style, which is a shift away from three-dimensionality in favor of a more uniform, flat visual plane. Over the years, McKinnon has pivoted between the traditional division of foreground, middle ground, and background, and blending those three layers into one. By doing so, he has leaned further into the realm of the conceptual. Instead of depicting concrete representations of creatures and places, he can now render the idea of those creatures and places instead. In Grim Return, for example, McKinnon shows us the process of being saved from death. It is a three-panel story that is easily told in comic books, but very difficult to achieve on a single magic card. A heavily washed-out background lets the viewer understand that this is not three different knights, but instead a progression of an action taken by one. Kumbaj Witches takes this a step further and asks the question, is this a dance between two women or a conceptualization of mortality? We all have to die, and coming to terms with that fact or remaining constantly at odds with it is what uniquely makes us human. The ethereal hair, the floating necklaces, and the mirroring of colors across the piece tell viewers to not take this image literally, but instead to ask what the piece has to say through symbolism and composition. Art can speak to you, and the mood through which it does will inform you of its message. Chrono Stutter is another example of an outstanding conceptual piece that tries to capture the vague idea of time. How do you depict what is so inherently abstract? I asked Seb about this piece, and he told me that the art description called for an ornate hourglass enveloping a human warrior who is struggling in the quicksand. He built upon this idea and made it his own by replacing the sand with pebbles, adding a pair of statues made of driftwood, and setting the scene in front of an open sea of gentle waves. The entire image is washed in a blue hue, which, again, gives it such a melancholic mood. McKinnon said that the idea of the ocean helped solidify the theme of time slowly and methodically eroding away all things. This piece is symmetrical, but not a simple mirror image of itself, which helps it feel more organic. It's an artwork that I love, and if I were an art director, I would continue to assign Seb McKinnon prompts that even I would have trouble defining. Hey Seb, can you show me the value in protecting the innocent? Hey Seb, you know the tinge of sadness that haunts a sunny Saturday afternoon? Paint that. Hey Seb, show me regret. For the Egyptian-inspired Plain of Amenket, McKinnon delivered another exceptional painting in Archfiend of Ifnir. Hopefully by now you can see all of the artist's signature elements coalescing to form a highly unusual render of a demon. Traditionally in magic and in folklore, these creatures are menacing and angry, hellishly pursuing the living to exploit their desires. McKinnon's demon is very much the opposite. It is taken aback and hides behind a leaning obelisk. Behind him are a series of cyclones, evoking an abstract danger that only bad weather brings. From the cloud of dust, the demon's wings emerge, which are loosely rendered and blended into the background. Upon closer inspection, you'll notice the creature's torso is two-dimensionally layered onto the plane, and its neck is turned a full 90 degrees to face the viewer. The stare is empty, a blank expression void of all emotion. Like an Odunis river trawler, Seb draws us to its face with a gentle wash of golden light atop its horns. The path below him invites us in, as if to say that the creature's shy, withdrawn posture suggests it is the one afraid of us. Once more, we have a symmetrically balanced piece. The weight of the tower pushes against the crooked and sinister body of the beast. Everything is perfectly still. And in writing this description, I realize I have seen this image once before. Seb's affinity with the German illustrator Niels Hamm is one he finds flattering. He has admired Niels' portfolio for a long while, and credits Hamm's ability to mix beauty and melancholy as a mutual goal of their work. Both artists' uncanny capacity to utilize digital brushes as if they were watercolor, and to push the boundaries of the format into places that traditional paint struggles to do itself, is what separates them from the common criticisms of digital artwork. Mike Linneman commented on this aspect in his art review of the Nicol Bolas Arch Enemy set. Seb has been on fire as of late for really interesting compositions and beautifully rendered textures. The "is he digital" questions I field on Twitter are far from zero, and that's wonderful. Niels and Seb are keeping people guessing, forcing people to appreciate the art first and think about the medium second. Their choices in opaque colors and roughened textures also very much lend themselves to the foiling process on physical magic cards. Not all foils harmonize with their respective compositions, but McKinnon's paintings tend to synchronize with the glimmer. So to bring the magic art of Seb McKinnon to a close, I invite you to take a moment to look at this piece. This is not an image common for our card game. It is largely two-dimensional and connotes the work of Leonora Carrington and, once again, John Bauer. Ask yourself how you feel, with whom you identify in the piece, as well as where your eye travels when you sit and observe it for a while. Whose side are you on? What does the arid and pinkish mountainscape behind the figures do for the piece? How does it benefit from foregoing the rules of painting with one-point perspective in favor of figures with very little spatial depth? What does the color red do? What happens if we choose to read this figuratively and symbolically instead of literally? How does this piece converse with the artist's prior work, namely the conceptual images we looked at earlier in this video? To ask such questions is to listen to what the artist has to say, and to hear their message. Thanks for watching. All of the music in this video was composed by Seb McKinnon under the name Clan. That's his music project, which set the soundscape, like I said in the header of this video, for his short films. Well, Seb wanted me to relay onto you guys that soon he will be releasing limited edition playmats, doing a Kickstarter so that he could fund a feature-length film for the Kin Fables project. It's his way of having his art fund his other art. So that's really cool. He's a Renaissance man. If you enjoyed the music, please reach out on Bandcamp. And if you enjoyed the video or Seb's art, then please reach out in the comments and tell me which one your favorite is. This video for me has been like 8 months in the making, so I've been excited about... it's just been ruminating, so I'm excited to finally put it out there. I think there's a lot of fans of Seb McKinnon in the magic community, so it felt good to finally do it. All right, guys. Thanks a lot for watching. I appreciate you. Cheers. In game one of the semifinals in the 2013 Magic World Championships, in a best-of-five match between Limited legend Ben Stark and up-and-coming young talent Shahar Shenhar, Stark would take a lightning bolt to the face, dropping his life total from 3-0 and moving the players into game two. Shahar would go on to win that match, and then upset Reid Duke in the finals to become the world champion, a title he would defend a year later at Worlds 2014 in Nice, France. Winning that tournament crowned him the first player in the history of the game to ever win back-to-back world championships, a feat that has not been matched since. Now, pointing a lightning bolt at an opponent on 3 life is nothing noteworthy, but what if I told you Ben Stark died with 2 Sphinx's Revelations, 2 Snapcaster Mages, and a Cryptic Command in hand, with a life-saving Lightning Helix on the stack? In addition, Shahar had 0 blue spells in his hand. His 1 card remaining after Lightning Bolt was just a Restoration Angel. To top it off, there were 22 lands in play between both players, and Shahar was not playing Burn. So how did that Bolt win the game? In June of 2017, Wizards of the Coast announced a mystery product called Iconic Masters, scheduled to be unveiled at HasCon later that year. Part of the set's appeal would be its complete lack of a preview season. The exclusive attendees of the convention would be the first to ever play with the set, offering a unique booster pack opening experience unseen since Magic's very early years. Before Twitter and the internet at large, players would resort to magazines like InQuest and The Duelist to learn about new cards, and even then, speculation about what a card did based only on its name meant that the perfect information we now routinely possess was rewarded only to the most devoted fans who did their research. Now, whether or not Wizards achieves their goal of keeping Iconic Masters under wraps until launch day is not the point of this video. Rather, I'm much more interested in that word, iconic, and what it means to Magic, because there are a handful of cards that are indisputably going to be part of that set. We can nearly guarantee that Sarah Angel, Shivan Dragon, and Counterspell will make the cut. Making a similar case for Lightning Bolt is a bit reductive, though, as I doubt any players would argue against its candidacy for inclusion. So I want to look instead at the card as an icon itself. What about it embodies Magic as a whole? And why, after 25 years, does this card still stand as such a strong point of reference for the game's designers and players alike? In other words, what makes Lightning Bolt so damn special? See, I like that question because even the game's most entrenched veterans will respond with a wide range of differing ideas. Let's start with some history. Lightning Bolt is as old as Magic itself. Appearing first in Alpha, it was Red's representative in what is called the Boon Cycle, a series of 5 instants for 1 mana that offered casters 3 of something relating to the spell's corresponding color. Making up the Boon Cycle are 5 cards that would set the tone for the game's 5 colors, some better than others.
So, with the Boon, I thought in fleshing out the colors that making something which represented the essence of that color in each would make a good skeleton for the game.
For example, Ancestral Recall, the blue spell of the bunch, allows players to draw 3 cards at instant speed for 1 mana. It has since been banned and restricted for its raw power, and even Richard Garfield, the game's creator, knew it was broken before Alpha hit the printing presses. White's Boon, Healing Salve, has had an opposite effect on the game. Preventing 3 damage or gaining 3 life is next to useless, rendering it the weakest of the bunch by far. Green got Giant Growth, the fairest and most reprinted card of the cycle. Black saw Dark Ritual, which I would rank right behind Ancestral Recall in terms of power level. And right in the middle was Lightning Bolt. Here, I believe, is the first instance of what makes Bolt iconic. From the beginning, it has established exactly what Red cares about most, and its ability to focus the color's main goals is partially a stroke of luck, and largely a testament to its ability to stay relevant. From Lightning Bolt would branch an entire series of what would later be called Burn Spells, cards that deal direct damage to creatures, players, or both. The thing is, since 1993, no card does Lightning Bolt better than Lightning Bolt. Many are imitators, following in function or in name. As of Hour of Devastation, 45 red cards have the word Lightning in them, most of which burn things just like Bolt. Compare this to Ancestral Recall. Not only are there far fewer ancestral cards, but they bleed into other colors and hardly reference drawing cards. Sure, blue has established itself as the game's best color for generating card advantage, but I don't think that is its main goal or even greatest strength now.
So, for example, card draw used to be specifically blue, and that's been moved around some because it was too rich a mechanic just to lock up with blue.
Dark Ritual is even further from Black's current position on the color pie. What I'm saying is, Lightning Bolt is iconic because after 25 years, it still represents its color to a T. Not only that, but the name itself can stand alone even outside of the context of the game. Ask the uninitiated to make their best guess at what Lightning Bolt does in Magic, and I bet you'd get far closer results than posing the same question subbing with Ancestral Recall or Dark Ritual. Card names are vital for bringing people into the game, and Bolt's simplicity acts as a stepping stone between the real world and one of high fantasy. Tell people that they are role-playing as a powerful wizard, pulling mystical spells from a metaphorical library represented by a stack of cards, and maybe they can play along. Show them lightning bolts and tell them they can throw the thunder like Zeus, and suddenly we have a game. Here's the other half of a good name. It lends itself to shorthand. I can say bolt to any magic player and they know exactly what I mean. 99% would never need to read the card in the middle of a game, and simply saying bolt you for lethal and flashing the card from my hand is enough to grant a concession. The same goes for so many of the game's most iconic cards. Force, mill, counter, path. All are nouns that have been simplified and turned into verbs which describe functions of the game. I know this is partially a symptom of linguistic flexibility and context. I can't say ooze, for example, and be sure you know I'm talking about scavenging ooze and not necrotic ooze. But lightning bolts being reduced to bolt is not just a nickname. It has become part of the game's vocabulary and acts as a stand-in that can reference any card with a similar function. Consider Bolt the Bird. Sure, this has become a saying that references a ubiquitous play sequence in the game's eternal formats, which is just shorthand for cast lightning bolts targeting birds of paradise.
And so you have to make a hard decision early in the game with not much information. Do I bolt the bird? What do you think, Randy?
But it can also mean, on a larger scale, kill a turn one mana producing creature.
I've been trained over the last 20 years. You just kill the bird.
That's definitely the conventional wisdom.
It's not just an interaction between two cards, but a fundamental strategy of playing Magic well at a high level.
And the bird gets bolted, and in fact, it is an actual lightning bolt on an actual Birds of Paradise.
So there you go.
Bolt the Bird is a mantra. It opens the door for players to learn the importance of resource management. On the flip side, bolt, snap, bolt has become a Magic catchphrase too, and is one that comes up when debating some of the game's most powerful combos and play patterns. Here is another reason that Lightning Bolt is an iconic card. It teaches both players and developers about the system it inhabits. Rewinding the clocks back again, Magic did not always have a limitation on the number of cards a player can run in a single deck. Richard Garfield never thought players would buy enough product to face such a problem. He was wrong, of course, and degenerate decks became rampant without the four of rule. Lightning Bolt helped shift the discussion for early R&D to create this rule. Running 40 Lightning Bolts and 20 Mountains in a 60-card deck was one strategy that proved nigh unstoppable in the game's early years. Limiting multiples of a single card to four in one deck solved this issue, in part thanks to Bolt. Fast forward to now, Lightning Bolt is a standard metric for analyzing a creature's toughness. It is the reference point when asking, is this card good enough to see eternal play? Does it die to Bolt? A myriad of articles have been written that dissect this question, and Bolt's ultra efficiency is the reason for the ongoing discussion. Of course, because of this, Lightning Bolt has always been in the crosshairs for a potential banning. Up until the printing of Fatal Push, it was the premier removal spell in Modern, and any deck running red would be unfit without a playset of four Lightning Bolts. Card strength, although not the main determinant for analyzing what makes a card iconic, certainly plays into the equation here. Bolt is just a good card, plain and simple, which is why it has been part of the game for so long. Mark Rosewater knows this too, and after discussing the card with other developers in March of 2017, he came to the conclusion that it is more powerful than Path to Exile because of its ability to hit players. See, Lightning Bolt is iconic because even in the face of power creep, it has conversely gotten better with age. With the printing of Planeswalkers back in Lorwyn came another hidden mode in Lightning Bolt's rules text. The ability to redirect damage to Planeswalkers meant that, in many game states, the card could kill them in one hit. That type of reach is partially what led to Shenhar's victory. If any of the game's greatest minds were to predict how this blue-white-red control mirror against Ben Stark would play out, I doubt any of them would say victory by Lightning Bolt. Yet, going back to Game 1, that was the exact recipe for success. This game is far and beyond one of my favorites I've ever watched. It is a masterclass in patience, and given the player's combined skill level, a perfect example of Bolt's versatility. For the first 9 or 10 turns of the game, both players simply played lands and passed the turn back and forth, neither wishing to put a spell on the stack out of fear of a counter war. Eventually, Shahar is the first to present a threat with Vendilion Click, which Stark allows to resolve.
This is impressive. You realize this is like turn 9 or 10 of the game? Zero spells have been cast. Here we are breaking the ice with a Vendilion Click.
Shenhar targets himself and cycles a path to exile. At this point, Alice Fee sees Bolt as a dead card. The game slowly grinds down as players jockey for board presence. They exchange win conditions and counter spells and even celestial colonnades to Tectonic Edges, which acts as both decks' main finisher. In the mid-game, Ben is far ahead of Shahar and should win this game.
Ben is ahead here, though. There's, make no mistake, he's behind on life totals, but if you look at Ben's hand, the fact that he's got three counter spells and a Snapcaster and a Revelation to Shahar's hand of basically lightning bolts, plus the, you know, nearly useless path to exile means that this is Ben's game to win.
But at a certain juncture, the top of the deck reveals a line of play that even LSV thought impossible as means to end this game.
Ooh. That was one of Shahar's best draws, the fourth bolt.
Yep.
And with the help of a seemingly irrelevant fetch land, Shahar pulls the trigger on his own end step.
So it looks like Shahar's gonna bolt Ben, Shahar's gonna bolt Ben. When Shahar goes for the lethal bolt, Ben's gonna helix, then Shahar's gonna have the fourth bolt to trump that.
And there's the lightning helix.
Response, lightning bolt here.
Good way to steal it, I think.
I think so.
And has Ben actually just stole the game, or Shahar just stole the game, as Ben said.
Good game!
As both Ben Stark and the commentary team stated, Lightning Bolt stole that game out of nowhere. Funnily enough, none of this would have been possible without its reprinting in the M10 core set. Prior to then, Lightning Bolt last appeared in 4th edition, which leads me to my final point about its status as an iconic card. As most experienced players know, Bolt's original artwork was done by Christopher Rush, a name that holds weight in the game's Hall of Fame. Rush was responsible for not only some of the game's most noteworthy cards, which have since become images of nostalgia for longtime vets, but also for the mana symbols that are still used to represent the 5 colors of magic. Players also know that very recently, in 2016, we lost Christopher Rush. Already a coveted piece of memorabilia, signed Alpha and Beta Lightning Bolts have become even more precious with his passing. In Magic 2010, when Lightning Bolt was reprinted, it arrived with 2 significant changes. The first, it had flavor text. Agreeing to reprint Bolt was the subject of great debate within R&D, but Forsyth's main goal of developing a set around dramatic and controversial cards meant that Lightning Bolt absolutely needed to appear in the set. Standard was also at a safe spot to cushion Bolt's arrival, so they tested the waters. Not often does the game break the fourth wall. That sort of self-referencing is usually reserved for unsets. However, Lightning Bolt's flavor text here does exactly that. The Spark Mage shrieked, calling on the rage of the storms of his youth. To his surprise, the sky responded with a fierce energy he'd never thought to see again. It reads, "I don't think anyone thought they'd see this card legal in Type 2, but it also meant modern players could harness the storm in the years to come as well." Now, as you can see, Christopher Rush's artwork was not present. In its place was an updated, more color-appropriate image done by Christopher Muller, another legendary illustrator of the game. Depicting in his comic book-inspired way a silhouette beckoning the skies from atop a snowy cliff, this image of Lightning Bolt, I would argue, has become the mainstay for the game's later generations. Speaking again to its simplicity, the artwork is a lightning bolt. It is straightforward and exactly what you would imagine, which synchronizes with the rest of the card's features. But consider this. Christopher Muller retired from contract work for Wizards of the Coast in early 2017.
So it's with very conflicted emotions that I announce my retirement from Magic.
This means for the second time in the game's history, artist-signed copies of the non-promo Lightning Bolt have reached their maximum supply. So looking again into the future, I wonder, what is in store for Lightning Bolt? Will it see a reprint in Iconic Masters? And if so, will another artist be given the opportunity to join the circle of legends who have provided such art before them? Will a new bolt come with new flavor text that references another aspect of the game? Will it become too format warping and fall to the banhammer, thereby elevating its status as one of the game's most iconic cards? There's no such thing as bad PR, they say. No matter what, I see Lightning Bolt as the perfect mascot for Magic. It can teach us about game design and strategy, provide an example to follow when creating new cards, and act as a point of reference for measuring card power. It can also change the way we experience high-level competition. It has that unique ability of reshaping a game out of nowhere. The top of the deck is always relevant when Lightning Bolt is in the format, which makes for engaging viewer experiences and allows Magic's built-in variants to provide a thrilling spectacle. And more than that, I think Lightning Bolt is pivotal for introducing new players to the game. It is the source of countless stories and wild game moments, and is understandable to anyone away from the context of a battlefield. And when inquiring about what makes a card iconic, just remember that game between Shahar and Ben Stark. Thanks for watching. My channel is now a proud partner of Card Kingdom. Use cardkingdom.com/studies to help support the show. All right, if you enjoyed this video, I want you to check out more card studies on my channel. I've done quite a few already, and if you don't want to go to my channel, then go to my website at rysticstudies.com. The biggest news, as you guys can tell from that end screen, is now I'm a partner of Card Kingdom, which is super, super, super exciting. I've been holding out for these guys for quite a while, and I'm happy to join the team. So if you want to help support the show and buy Magic products, you guys know what to do. Just use the affiliate link /studies to do that. Okay, so as you know from my Patreon, I do signed cards every month. And of course, this month we're going to be signing Lightning Bolts. So if you'd like to support the show a little more directly, just go to my Patreon page and get yourself signed up with perks. All right, so you guys can get signed cards and your name alongside these lovely people in the credits. You know how we do. All right, if you have any specific stories about Lightning Bolts or little anecdotes you'd like to share, go ahead and leave a comment. You know what to do. And I will see you very, very soon for the next video. It will be a Magic Art Study, so welcome to my new place. I need to put up some art. I don't know if you know this, but Niels Hom sent me a piece of art, an alternate version of his mountain from M13 that I love so much that I used in this video. So that's going to get framed very soon, and I promise you will be seeing that in one of the next videos to come up. All right, that's it. Mom got me this nice little cup from Disneyland, and I'm drinking coffee this morning. So thanks for watching, guys. Of course, I appreciate y'all. Cheers.
Sun is down, I'm freezing cold. That's how we already know when it's here. My dog will probably do it for Louis Bell. That's just all he know, he don't know nothing else. I tried to show him. Yeah. Gone on you with the pick and roll. Younger flame, he in sicko mode. Make this here with all the ice on in the booth. At the gate outside, when they pull up, they give me loose. Yeah, jump out, boys, that's Nike boys hopping our coupes. Way too big, when we pull up, give me the loot. Was off the Remy, had up at Post. Had to hit my old town to duck the news. 2-4-hour lockdown, we made no moves. Now it's 4 a.m. and I'm back up popping with the crew. I just landed in, Chase B mixes pop like Jamba Juice. Different color chains, think my jewelry really selling fruits. And they joking, man, know the c***s wish it wasn't new.
Sunset. The river retreat, we all in too deep. Play for keeps, don't play us a week.
Sunset.
The river retreat, we all in too deep. Play for keeps, don't play us a week.
Way too formal, y'all know I don't follow suit. Stacy Dash, most of these girls ain't got a clue. All of these I made off records I produce. I might take all my exes and put them all in a group. Hit my essays, I need the boot.
About to turn this function in the binary room. Told her I've been, you coming too. In the 305, treat me like I'm Uncle Luke. Had to slot the top off, it's just a roof. She said, where we going? I set the moon. We ain't even make it to the room. She thought it was the ocean, it's just a pool. Now I gotta open, it's just a goon. Who put this together? I'm the glue.
Someone said.
Shorty face, Tommy out the blue.
Someone said. Someone said, motherfucker. Someone said.
Okay, I've been up for some days, I ain't got time to lay. Just to drown out all these thoughts, I tried all kind of things. If I take you to my past, you will be traumatized. Got 1,000 kids outside, it's trying to come alive. 99 to cash a wallet, had to relocate. Told the dolls I bring it back, it was a seal of fate. Before no car knows, baby girl, she played the tourist guide. Got the keys into my city, now she notarized. Got new money, got new problems, got new enemies. When you make it to the top, it's the amenities. Packing out Toyota like I'm in the league. And it ain't a mosh pit if ain't no injuries. I got him stage diving out the nosebleeds. Yeah, this right here is astronomical. I see you picked up on my ways, I feel responsible. They're trying to say that all my problems is improbable. They keep itching at my spit, I'm diabolical, you feel me? Goosebumps every time I need the Heimlich. Throw that to the side, yo. I get those goosebumps every time, yeah. When you're not around, when you throw that to the side, yo. I get those goosebumps every time, yeah. 713 through the 281, yeah, I'm riding. Why they on me? Why they on me? I'm flying, sipping low key. I'm sipping low key in Onyx, find a rider. When I'm pulling up right beside you, pop star Lil Mariah. When I text, kick game wireless, throw a stack on the Bible, never Snapchat.